What's much ado about nothing really about, according to Pantaloon? The play is constructed from two plots. In the first, the bad brother, Don John, schemes to destroy a marriage between Claudio and Hero. To do this, he uses deception. In the second plot, the good brother, Don Pedro, schemes to create a marriage between Beatrice and Benedick. And to achieve this, he also uses deception. When we examine the story in more detail, we see many other attempts to deceive. The gentlemen all dress up in masks, and Don Pedro pretends to Hero that he's Claudio. Then Antonio, similarly masked, insists to Ursula that he's not Antonio. And meanwhile, Benedick, behind a mask, refuses to admit his identity to Beatrice. Finally, Don John deceives Claudio by pretending to believe that the masked young man is Benedick. And Claudio agrees with him, thinking that he is deceiving Don John. But the villain, in fact, fools Claudio into believing that Don Pedro has deceived his friend by pretending to woo Hero on Claudio's behalf, while actually wooing her for himself. Don John's fraud, however, is only temporarily successful, and the truth is established. Then Pedro's fraud begins. The tricking of Benedick is introduced by a song which includes the lyric, "Men were deceivers ever." And then Pedro, Claudio, and Leonardo have a staged conversation while pretending that they don't know that Benedick is eavesdropping. They furthermore deceive him into believing that Beatrice is in love with him. A parallel scene shows Hero, Margaret, and Ursula pretending that they don't know that Beatrice is eavesdropping, while they deceive her into believing that Benedick is in love with her. So Don Pedro's plan to trick both Benedick and Beatrice is succeeding. Meanwhile, Don John's plot has made great progress. He deceives Claudio and Pedro into believing that Margaret's staged liaison with Baraccio is actually Hero being unfaithful to Claudio. The scheme's success is measured by the disruption of the wedding ceremony by appalling accusations against Hero and savage vilification by her father. Ironically, the solution to the crisis, proposed by the friar, is yet another deception. They will all pretend that Hero is dead. Leonardo and Antonio then try to provoke a sword fight with Pedro and Claudio based on the lie that they have caused Hero's death. Benedick similarly issues a challenge to Claudio on the same pretense. However, the watch manage to discover the truth about Don John's villainy, and so Baraccio is arrested and is able to boast to Pedro and Claudio that he has deceived them. The play ends with Claudio doing an act of penance, still in the belief that Hero is dead, and then being tricked into believing that a masked lady is Hero's cousin. When he agrees to marry her, the last great deception is revealed as Hero unmasks. So clearly, much of the plot hinges on deception. But that doesn't mean the play is about deception. To be that, it would have to shed some new light on the subject. No. To explore what the play's about, we need to examine the language. Firstly, let's consider the play's title. Much Ado About Nothing might suggest that we are being given a busy entertainment with little emotional depth. But in fact, the disrupted marriage ceremony does include plenty of powerful emotion. Claudio could have called off the wedding in advance, but instead, he postpones his accusation so as to allow Hero to anticipate the greatest pleasure, and then to feel the maximum shock and the fiercest pain. And her suffering is increased by the public humiliation she's subjected to, and the fact that she is denounced as a sinner during the ceremony of the sacrament of marriage. Claudio's calculated cruelty reeks of sadistic relish. He enjoys his revenge. Then Leonardo joins in. Instead of rushing to comfort his daughter and defend her, he pours further condemnation on her and wishes her dead. The self-righteous and self-regarding outbursts from the men seem all the more repellent because the helpless young woman is surrounded by a gang of brutal males. So the much ado in the title may refer to the shattering impact of these passionate explosions. Perhaps the title has a further significance, particularly in the word nothing, if it's pronounced no thing. The word thing is used elsewhere in Shakespeare's plays as a euphemism for the male sexual organ, and I've actually heard it used in this sense in modern conversation. And correspondingly, no thing was apparently slang for the female sexual organ, since women have no thing. This interpretation of the title does seem convincing. The accusation against Hero is that she has already lost her virginity. Everyone is fixated on the state of her no thing. She's condemned for having lost her honour. And the men claim in their primitive way that she has thus besmirched their honour. The play certainly includes much ado fueled by obsessions about her no thing. Much ado about no thing. But there is another meaning in the title, which is more significant and far-reaching throughout the play. Experts inform us that nothing was pronounced like noting. Now, this is crucial and leads us to a whole new area to examine. Balthazar, before he sings, plays on different meanings of note. Note this before my notes. There's not a note of mine that's worth the noting. And Don Pedro's reply links noting and nothing. Note notes, forsooth, and nothing. I've already listed examples of deception in the story, but in every case, the trickery only works because the victim's powers of perception are very unreliable. All their noting of people and situations is liable to be untrustworthy. They can't believe their eyes. They can't believe their ears. They can't believe their other senses. But unfortunately, it is from our senses that we gain our impressions of reality. How else do we know what's out there? If we can't trust our eyes and ears and so on, how can we ever be sure that anything we believe is true? And that is what I think Much Ado About Nothing is really about. The unreliability of our senses. The impossibility of being certain of anything. The problems of noting. When Claudio asks Benedick for his opinion of Hero, he uses the word note. "Didst thou note the daughter of Signor Leonardo?" And Benedick replies that he sees her differently. "I noted her not, but I looked on her." Already they are comparing contradictory impressions of Hero. Then, after Claudio has announced at the wedding ceremony that he can see that Hero is guilty, the friar says he has perceived that she is innocent by scrutinizing her, by noting of the lady. Later, Leonardo demands to see the villain Baraccio so that, "when I note another man like him, I may avoid him." Although it is probable that he will remain just as gullible. And at the end, when Hero reveals her true identity, she informs Claudio, "nothing certainer," which may play on the two meanings, nothing and noting. In fact, nothing can ever be certain, because noting is never certain. We are all vulnerable to mistakes caused by our treacherous sense impressions. I need to substantiate these assertions by giving some examples of references to our unreliable senses. I'll start by quoting key lines about sight. Claudio immediately registers Hero's attractions in these terms. "In mine eye, she's the sweetest lady that ever I looked on." And Benedick disagrees in similar language. "I can see yet without spectacles, and I see no such matter." Correspondingly, Beatrice boasts that she is too perceptive to go blindly into marriage. "I have a good eye, uncle. I can see a church by daylight." Then Claudio tells Pedro about his altered view of Hero. Originally, he looked upon her with a soldier's eye, but now he sees her with a lover's eye. And just before being tricked, Benedick asks, "May I be converted and see with these eyes?" But straight afterwards, he indicates the complete change produced by the deception. "I do spy some marks of love in her." When the wedding is interrupted, Claudio is confident that he can believe his senses. "Are our eyes our own?" But then vows to be suspicious in future. "On my eyelids shall conjecture hang." Unfortunately, this is unimpressive because he earlier fell into a similar trap when he was convinced that Don Pedro had betrayed him, and he then vowed to trust no one. "Let every eye negotiate for itself." Leonardo is also convinced that he can now see the truth about Hero. "Why ever wast thou lovely in my eyes?" But Baraccio is able to taunt his victims for their mistaken impressions. "I have deceived even your very eyes." And in the final scene, Benedick alludes to altered impressions. "Your niece regards me with an eye of favour, and I do with an eye of love requite her." There are other references to the sense of sight, but I think that's enough to make my point. 'Cause a night-
matter to me. So remember when you tell those little white lies that the night has a thousand eyes.
And so we come to the next of our senses, hearing. One of the first things we learn about Beatrice and Benedick is that they both like the sound of their own voices. She attacks him with, "I wonder that you will still be talking, Signor Benedick. Nobody marks you." And he soon strikes back with, "I would my horse had the speed of your tongue." And later dubs her Lady Tongue. But Leonardo has already warned us that all this constant noise is not as aggressive as it sounds. "You must not, sir, mistake my niece. And there is a kind of merry war betwixt Signor Benedick and her." We soon encounter another example of the unreliability of our ears. In the second scene, Antonio says that his man has overheard Don Pedro and Claudio talking. But the servant erroneously believes that Pedro said that he was the one in love with Hero. Then in the third scene, Baraccio tells Don John a similar tale. But it's another mistake made by eavesdropping. The tricking of Benedick, when he is also eavesdropping, begins with him complaining about the unreliability of Claudio's reactions to sounds. "I have known when there was no music with him, but the drum and the fife. And now had he rather hear the tabor and the pipe." Ironically, of course, his own perceptions are about to be transformed. Don Pedro provides a song to create a suitably romantic atmosphere, but Benedick is tone deaf. "Is it not strange that sheep's guts should hail souls out of men's bodies?" And he had been a dog that should have howled thus. They would have hanged him. Yet by the end of the scene, he is totally taken in by all he hears. "I should think this a gull, but that the white-bearded fellow speaks it." And "the conference was sadly born." So the man who prides himself on his skill with words listens carefully and is fooled. The duping of Benedick in prose is comic, whereas the parallel episode involving Beatrice in verse is more serious in tone. He is controlled by the lies he hears, and in his clumsy masculine way, he wriggles to justify his complete volte-face. But she readily accepts the criticisms against her and exclaims in the music of rhymed verse at the change to her hearing. "What fire is in my ears?" She declares that, unlike Benedick, she is not simply being manipulated by others' speeches, but is responding to her own convictions. "I believe it better than reportingly." Don Pedro had hoped that his scheme would achieve the impossible. It would silence Beatrice and Benedick's incessant babble. "That's the scene that I would see, which will be merely a dumb show." His success is signalled by Benedick being uncharacteristically quiet, while Claudio and Pedro make jokes about his taciturnity. "Nay, but his jesting spirit, which is now crept into a lute string and now governed by stops." Similarly, a subdued Beatrice is outwitted by Margaret, whose tongue, by comparison, is now quicker and sharper. Beatrice asks, What a pace is this that thy tongue keeps? And Margaret replies, Not a false gallop. Words and sounds continue to be deceptive throughout the play. For Claudio's penance, he reads a poem and listens to a song, both of which bewail Hero's death. But of course, his heartfelt regret when he hears these sounds is undermined by the fact that she's actually still alive. Beatrice and Benedick characteristically end the play with another skirmish of words. So their apparent hostility has to be, as Don Pedro said, reduced to a dumb show when they are appropriately silenced by a kiss. Peace. I will stop your mouth. So far, I've given examples of the unreliability of our eyes and our ears. But the conversion of Benedick from bachelor to married man is also indicated by changes to his sense of taste. Although Beatrice says that in warfare he hath an excellent stomach, and he is meat food for her disdain, she adds that if his wit is not recognized, the fool will eat no supper. He certainly proclaims that Beatrice is not to his taste. Here's a dish I love not. I cannot endure my lady tongue. This sobriquet combines two of the senses. He doesn't like to taste tongue, the meat served at a meal, or hear Beatrice's scornful tongue. Don Pedro decides that he will have to whet Benedict's appetite for love. In despite of his quick wit and his queasy stomach. Just before he is tricked, Benedict complains about the changes wrought in Claudio by love. His words are a very fantastical banquet. Just so many strange dishes. But he's ready to swallow the deception. Claudio says, Bait the hook well, this fish will bite. By the end of the scene, Leonardo is able to be confident that Benedict's appetite for Beatrice has indeed been whetted. Dinner is ready. Comically, after his earlier scorn of marriage, Benedick tries to excuse his total change. But doth not the appetite alter? A man loves the meat in his youth that he cannot endure in his age. And Beatrice's next words continue the theme. I'm sent to bid you come in to dinner. But she assumes that his appetite has not changed. You have no stomach, signor. However, Margaret later observes the change in him. He swore he would never marry, and yet now in despite of his heart, he eats his meat without grudging. In contrast, Don John is incapable of amending his taste. I must eat when I have stomach, and derives nourishment from causing harm. This may prove food to my displeasure. His enjoyment of a meal doesn't, as it does in Claudio and Benedick, reflect a readiness for marriage. On the contrary, his letters to the great supper indicates his taste for poisoning a marriage. Next of the senses to be involved in the bodily changes caused by falling in love is touch, especially when it is like feeling ill. Beatrice mocks Benedict's friendship with Claudio in these terms. He will hang upon him like a disease. He's sooner caught than the pestilence. If he have caught the Benedick, it will cost him £1,000 ere he be cured. She, however, is confident that she can control her own body, responding to, "You will never run mad, niece," with, "No, not till a hot January." Benedick likewise describes a relationship with her as a kind of illness. "She would infect to the North Star." And Claudio repeats the term when Benedick is being tricked. "He hath taken the infection." Hero uses the familiar phrase, "Benedick is sick in love with Beatrice." And Beatrice concedes, "I am sick," which allows Margaret to tauntingly recommend a medicine, "Carduus Benedictus." Meanwhile, Benedick has excused his physical change by pretending that he is suffering from another ailment. "I have the toothache." Don John, incapable of love, wants to wreak fatal physical changes on the others, especially by poison. "I would the cook were of my mind." His plot to create pain for Claudio is all that makes him feel better. "Any impediment will be medicinable to me. I am sick in displeasure to him." He even desires the death of this marriage. And Baraccio urges him, "The poison of that lies in you to temper." It is no wonder that Beatrice's reaction to Don John is acutely physical. "I can never see him, but I'm heartburned an hour after." The play even includes a few references to changes produced in the sense of smell. Benedick is mocked for having suddenly started using perfume. "Nay, he rubs himself with civet. Can you smell him out by that?" Then in the parallel scene, Hero taunts Beatrice with, "These gloves the Count sent me. They're an excellent perfume." And Beatrice replies, "I am stuffed, cousin. I cannot smell." So that means that each of our five senses is demonstrated to be unreliable. And it leaves us with the conclusion that all human beings are vulnerable to deception by others. And that we are also liable to deceive ourselves by making judgments based on innocent mistakes. We are constantly shown how appearances can be misleading. The tricking of Benedick is prefaced by Don Pedro registering Balthazar's modesty about his singing. "It is the witness still of excellency to put a strange face on his own perfection." Leonardo similarly suggests that Beatrice is hiding the truth. "Most wonderful that she should dote on Signor Benedick, whom she hath in all outward behaviours seemed ever to abhor." And the trio discuss whether "she doth but counterfeit." Benedick is taken in by Leonardo's appearance. "Knavery cannot hide himself in such reverence." Don Pedro jokingly admits that Benedick hath indeed a good outward happiness. And the success of his deception is shown by Benedick. "They have the truth of this from Hero. They seem to pity the lady. Ironically, Don John admits, I cannot hide what I am, and I am a plain-dealing villain. But his lies are still believed. Firstly, when he tells Claudio that Pedro is stealing Hero, and again, when he asserts that Hero is unfaithful. Don John is such a stranger to pretense that it is Baraccio who has to mastermind the duplicity so covertly that no dishonesty shall appear in me, urging Don John to warn Claudio that he is like to be cousined with the semblance of a maid, and manufacturing seeming truth of Hero's disloyalty. This, of course, results in Claudio's self-righteous denunciation of Hero at the wedding. He viciously and erroneously brands her a rotten orange. Her attractive exterior supposedly hides corruption inside. She's but the sign and semblance of her honour. Behold, how like a maid she blushes here. Oh, what authority and show of truth can cunning sin cover itself withal? He continues his vitriolic outburst. Seeming, I will write against it. You seem to me as Dian in her orb. But all the time, he's completely wrong. Even while he is exclaiming against seeming, he actually is being the victim of it. Sadly, Claudio is unlikely to learn his lesson. Earlier, when Don John convinced him that Pedro had betrayed him by wooing Hero for himself, Claudio had vowed to trust no agent. But he does trust John again by believing his lies about the lady. The friar suggests that to remedy the situation, the only option is to hoodwink Claudio once more. Everyone must pretend that she is dead and maintain a mourning ostentation. The strategy works. The ever-suggestible Claudio switches once more. Sweet Hero, now thy image doth appear in the rare semblance that I loved it first. And when the young dupe goes to get married a second time, the masked Hero is just as much a mystery to him as she ever was. These differences in appearances are signalled by the many occurrences of the word fashion. Sometimes it is a noun, referring to changes of clothes occasioned by contemporary style, which altered the way one is perceived. Benedict complains that Claudio's appearance has changed since he fell in love. He would have walked 10 miles afoot to see good armour, and now will he lie 10 nights awake, carving the fashion of a new doublet. Yet, of course, when Benedict falls in love, his new appearance, without a beard, is mocked by Pedro, and he is accused of a fancy that he hath to strange disguises. Then Margaret praises Hero's appearance in her wedding dress. Your gown's a most rare fashion. But the audience are aware that Claudio is going to accuse her of being a sham, despite her outward attractiveness. The other use of the word fashion is as a verb, meaning to contrive the appearance of something so as to achieve a desired effect. This is the sense in which Don Pedro uses the word when he determines to make Beatrice and Benedick fall in love. I doubt not but to fashion it. And the friar recommends a similar contrivance to deceive Claudio. Doubt not but success will fashion the event in better shape than I can lay it down in likelihood. Don John, on the other hand, initially refuses to alter his appearance to affect others' feelings. To fashion a carriage, to rob love from any. And so in order to arrange the deception of Claudio, he needs Baraccio, who promises, I will so fashion the matter. Later, when the drunken Baraccio blabs his secrets in public, he uses both the senses of fashion. What a deformed thief this fashion is! How giddily he turns about all the hot bloods, sometimes fashioning them like Pharaoh's soldiers! He even includes fashion in a sentence with the ambiguous no thing. Thou knowest that the fashion of a doublet is no thing to a man. Variations in clothes affect the way others are noting you. However, although Baraccio has fooled Claudio and Pedro by fashioning the situation with Margaret, he is unable to fashion an explanation to fool the watch. One would hope that the problems might be solved by the application of the intellect and rationality, but the play demonstrates that wit and reason are not always sufficient. When Antonio's servant says that Pedro is in love with Hero, Leonardo asks, Hath the fellow any wit that told you this? But Antonio insists, A good sharp fellow. Yet the man is mistaken. In a similar way, Beatrice and Benedick pride themselves on their clever minds, displayed in each skirmish of wit. And Beatrice asserts her superiority. If he have wit enough to keep himself warm, it is all the wealth that he hath left to be known a reasonable creature. She feels slighted by Benedick's accusation that I had my good wit out of the 100 merry tales, and she strikes back with, His commendation is not in his wit. But the limitations of this kind of intelligence are exposed when Benedick is so easily duped while eavesdropping. Pedro concedes that Benedick shows some sparks that are like wit, but criticizes him for his contemptible spirit. And the eavesdropper accepts that his witticisms should be subordinated to emotion. I will be horribly in love with her. He's even prepared to subject himself to the kind of raillery that he is accustomed to mete out to others. I may chance have some odd quirks and remnants of wit broken on me. In the parallel scene, Beatrice is similarly censured. Her wit values itself so highly, and is specifically condemned for being intellectually gifted, but emotionally inadequate. She cannot love. However, she responds in the heartfelt candour of rhymed verse, and determines to reform. Contempt, farewell. Claudio and Don Pedro also enjoy demonstrating their cleverness by mocking Benedick when, to placate Beatrice, he confronts them. Wilt thou use thy wit? And what a pretty thing man is when he goes in his doublet and hose and leaves off his wit. But their confidence in their brains takes a knock when it is proved that their wisdoms be misled in this. And it is the self-deprecating friar, call me fool who perceives the truth. Meanwhile, the villain's plot, which deluded Claudio and Pedro, is revealed by the watch, social and intellectual inferiors. Despite the hindrance of Dogberry's conceit about his own intelligence, we will spare no wit, and I am a wise fellow. In the final scene, Beatrice and Benedick are still reluctant to surrender the supremacy of reason. When Benedick asks her if she loves him, she replies, no more than reason. And when she asks him if he loves her, she receives the same answer. However, they finally abandon their reliance on their intellects and allow their bodies to take over when they kiss. So even reason and wit cannot guarantee a confident apprehension of reality. It might be possible sometimes for victims of misunderstandings to react in a restrained, skeptical manner. Leonardo is able to suspend judgment on the allegation that Pedro hopes to marry Hero. We will hold it as a dream till it appear itself. Furthermore, Beatrice prides herself on her ability to keep passion in check. I thank God and my cold blood. But Baraccio's contempt for the hot bloods clearly applies to Claudio, who assumes that Pedro has betrayed him because he is similarly passionate. Faith melteth into blood. Leonardo takes the same view. Wisdom and blood combating, blood hath the victory. At the marriage ceremony, Claudio denies the authenticity of Hero's blushes. Comes not that blood as modest evidence to witness simple virtue? While, ironically, his faith in Hero has melted into the blood of his passionate outburst. The calm friar, however, contradicts Claudio's interpretation of the blood in Hero's cheeks. I have marked 1,000 blushing apparitions to start into her face, 1,000 innocent shames. Yet Leonardo is ruled by aggression. Either, if she's guilty, he will attack Hero. These hands shall tear her! Or, if she is innocent, he will attack the princes. Time hath not yet so dried this blood of mine. And later, he's still determined to give priority to his emotions. I will be flesh and blood! Even Beatrice is overwhelmed by her feelings when demanding that Benedick take revenge. Kill Claudio! And goes to passionate extremes. I would eat his heart in the marketplace! As Leonardo said, blood has the victory. So, what is Much Ado About Nothing really about? Well, it seems to me that it's about the impossibility of ever being certain of our perception of reality. We can never really know anything. And of course, the word know crops up throughout the play. When the men dress up in masks, know signifies simply the process of identification. Baraccio says, that is Claudio. I know him by his bearing. But when Claudio, pretending to be Benedick, tells Don John, you know me well, The word takes on a second implication. Don John may interpret it ironically as, "You understand my gullible character." Similarly, in the same scene, when Beatrice tells the masked Benedick, "I'm sure you know him well enough," she may be insisting that everyone is familiar with Benedick and with his bumptious behaviour. But his subsequent complaint, "That my Lady Beatrice should know me and not know me," begins with "no" meaning "be familiar with," and then moves to "no" meaning "appreciate the value of." It's already difficult for the audience, as well as the characters, to know exactly what he's meant when anyone uses the word "no." The unreliability of all knowledge is played on by Don John when he asks Claudio, "Means your lordship to be married tomorrow?" And Pedro replies, "You know he does." And then Don John announces, "I know not that when he knows what I know," and proceeds to contradict everything that Claudio thinks he knows about Hero. Then at the wedding, Claudio seizes on the friar's words, "If either of you know any inward impediment," and demands, "Know you any, Hero?" When the friar inquires, "Know you any, Count?" Claudio exclaims, "What men daily do, not knowing what they do." But of course, the irony is that Claudio thinks that he previously didn't know what he was doing, whereas in fact, he now does not know what he's doing. Then further irony occurs when Leonardo asks whether Claudio has taken Hero's virginity, and he replies, "I know what you would say, if I have known her." But the truth is that he has neither known her sexually nor known her personally. His bride is actually a completely unknown quantity. When the friar asks Hero, "What man is he you are accused of?" she replies, "They know that do accuse me. I know none. If I know more of any man alive than that which maiden modesty doth warrant, let all my sins lack mercy." Her "no" can mean possess information, or be familiar with, or be intimate with. However, the central significance of "no" is that Claudio and Pedro are certain in their perception of reality, but they don't actually know what they're talking about. Claudio doesn't really know Hero, even when he finally does marry her. Benedick doesn't really know Beatrice, and even Beatrice doesn't really know Benedick. We in the audience often know more than the characters do, and are entertained by their stumbling in the dark. But do we pride ourselves on our own superiority? Or do we admit that we also are vulnerable to emotional explosions based on insufficient evidence? Our tendency to make much ado about nothing. Do we excuse ourselves like Claudio? "Yet sinned I not, but in mistaking." Or do we include ourselves in the company of fools, unstable beings whose unreliable perceptions only offer us a shaky grasp on reality? Do we agree with Benedick? "Man is a giddy thing. And this is my conclusion.
To know you is to love you. Just to see you smile makes my life worthwhile. To know you is to love you.